My story is about a Mormon family who were part of the MK Ultra program started by Operation Paperclip and masterminded by our original handler, Mr. Greenhog. To us, he was Mr. Greenhog, but there is reasonable evidence to suggest that his real name was Josef Mengele, who always liked to use names with the word green in them. My family were used as entertainers, child pilots in wars, medics, special messengers, high-priced call girls, presidential models, sports figures, and international spies. There were 13 children, and then my mother raised one more. This story is about generational incest, abuse, CIA kiddie porn distribution, and satanic ritual families that have no idea what they are involved in on a conscious level. It's about mind wipes, controlling those that have the most to offer. It's about how the priesthood, sacred societies, Freemasonry, and a satanic pedophilic agenda is widely used to control governments, religions, and local police to do their bidding. The darkness loves to hide behind the light, so it may shock you to hear about a Mormon bishop that tried to rape a friend of mine right after she got married. And this was the same high-up Mormon priesthood leader that later officiated in a satanic ritual where he almost got away with raping, killing, and offering my sisters up to an unknown god in the Salt Lake City Temple. But it's also about the power of love and acceptance and trust. It's about one woman's search for answers and healing and the story of how she found her true love. He's in the audience today, and I want you all to know that I would never have made it to this moment in time without him. Thank you, Dean. Dean's astounding work talks about the language of the body's organs and glands. The colon, for instance, is about eliminating that which no longer nurtures us, which is a function of hatred. If we stay true to our spirit, we figure out how to eliminate what no longer nurtures us, and the hatred goes away. Another organ lesson for me was about the thyroid. The problem with all thyroid issues is when we have the inability to correct personal justice, which creates the emotion of anxiety. Anxiety is just a warning sign telling us that something is not right, so we can correct it. But if you can't or won't do anything about personal injustices, you will take on a drag that causes you to be numb or disconnects you from that warning signal about what doesn't feel right. And that is what Dean and I call the dragon. So where does that leave us today? Today, victims are blamed and perpetrators are let off the hook or ignored. There's a fuzzy line between them. Even children are blamed for being raped in some sicker circles of society. Dean says there is no limit to the perversity of the dragon, and this needs to be corrected. When my father went to prison for his crimes, there was a collective sigh of relief for the thyroids in our family. The perpetrator was finally in a place he could not hurt us or any other children during that time. He was the guilty party, and we were the victims. Society came forward and, by putting him in prison, showed us that and made this right. It was a public clarification about who was guilty and who was not. But he was a victim too. So this is a tricky subject. However, when it comes to killing a child, there is a line that is crossed, and even the worst perps know it. Today, I speak for all victims of a nameless, faceless perpetrator that still hides behind ruling elite families, secret societies, governments, and religions, all providing a cover for the most heinous crimes on the planet. And what doesn't feel right to me is that these crimes, for the most part, still await punishment. And only when appropriate punishments are allowed will both victims and perpetrators be allowed to heal. Dean said that telling the truth is the greatest human trauma because it has been punished over the centuries more than anything else. So everyone has this in their genetic memory and are triggered whenever they do it, which is why so many keep their experiences to themselves. I began telling my story in 1998 under the pseudonym Sue Ellen in a series called Phoenix Undead Part 1 and 2 by John Quinn, who published it. Since sharing it, I've lost a 20-year singing career, lots of money, my health, and my home in an illegal foreclosure just this last December that left us homeless. My thanks to our dear friend Jenny for getting us here today and believing in me and what I have to say. My sister Nancy tried to tell and was shamed and got sent away to Aunt Daisy. My sister Dawn tried to tell and got sent to a Catholic convent with bars on the doors. Priscilla tried to tell and went to CPS. Irene witnessed a rape of her sister and she took a gun and shot herself in the stomach. Pamela tried to tell and divorced herself from all of us for over 20 years and couldn't bring herself to attend my mother's funeral. April tried to tell and got her children taken away and put in prison trying to get them back. So I applaud my brave sisters for coming forward and having the courage to tell me their stories. And I apologize to them publicly for not really hearing them or believing them at first. The first sex abuse story I heard in my family was from my oldest sister, Nancy, who was 16 at the time, who told me that she had to leave home because my dad had fondled her breasts and tried to have sex with her. She said that she told the bishop and he told her to keep it quiet so as not to break up the family or hurt the church. I kept Nancy's secret and didn't even tell mom or the bishop that I knew, which was kind of heavy for a 10-year-old. But if Nancy's story was hard to believe, let's just say that it was impossible for me to believe my closest sister April when her memories began to return. She talked about secret rituals and babies getting their hearts eaten and stuff that made me think she just needed medication or had maybe watched too many vampire movies. So April and I were best friends and she told me everything, which was the problem. This is April way back when, and here's a picture of her when Bill Clinton was turning her into a high-priced call girl. Then 10-year-old Dawn started running away from home after being gang raped. And this was in a little town in Santa Maria called Santa Maria, or a little town called Santa Maria, California. And Priscilla was sent to a foster home because Dad had mistaken her one night for my mother and slept with her. Now, she was only 14 at the time. Dad wrote me from Hawaii months later on a little old paper sack saying he had woken up from having amnesia, and I believed him. I begged the judge to forgive my dad, and guess what? He did, asking Dad to never do it again. In 2002, when my brother died, a sister attending his funeral told me that he molested her often as a child. He would promise her $10, molest her, then steal the money back from her. April came in when Dawn was telling me what happened and said, oh yes, he did the same thing to me. I was so mad I couldn't even see straight at the funeral. He was honored as a high priest before he died. And I thought, what the heck is wrong with this family and this church? I needed answers. I was 42 in 1997 when I saw Cathy O'Brien speak. There were only 13 of us in the audience at the Little America Hotel. I had just had a hysterectomy and could barely get out of bed, so I wasn't going to go until I had a heart prompting that was very strong to go hear her speak. And I literally put on a robe and I got in my friend's car and we went. Cathy and I talked afterward and she told me that she remembered me and my family during her Mormon MK Ultra days, which later explained Alex Houston's brief history with our family in our county fair days, and that was a stunner. But finally, my sister's crazy stories began to make some sense. Because I'd heard them all before, but the next day, I called Dawn first to apologize for not believing her when she first told me about being in the military. I asked her to again repeat what happened to her and told her that I would believe her this time. Enter Operation Mockingbird. When my sister Dawn joined the Armory, she was on a base where enlistees became Hollywood stars. She repeated that experience where a surprising number ended up being movie stars. She gave me a long list, and it would surprise you who they are, or maybe not. Talents were showcased, lots of parties went on constantly, and she noted that drugs were everywhere present on the military base and literally free for the asking. She told me how she was asked to meet with a man across the street from the military base. When she was there, she saw Crystal Gale, sister of Loretta Lynn, in white military garb outside the door, who saluted to the man she was to meet. This coincided with Cathy O'Brien's story exactly about Loretta Lynn, who was Crystal Gale's sister. So now I was beginning to get it. It was a short meeting with this man. When inside his office, he asked her if she could keep a secret. She said yes. He said, well, we'll see. She was asked to report back to him and bring her guitar with her in 2 weeks. At the end of 2 weeks, she was sitting back in the same chair in front of him. He said, well, we found out that you can keep a secret. He then began to read something like a dossier that encapsulated her entire life story on a few pages. She asked him how and why he knew so much about her, and he matter-of-factly answered, your dad sold you to us. She was shocked and grabbed the pages he was reading, and what spilled on the floor were dossiers with pictures of each of her brothers and sisters, including me. Of note, these were military dossiers. Funny thing, I don't remember joining the military. So why did they have a military dossier on me? April said we had been heavily used and deserved back pay for our childhood. So back to Dawn. After helping this military entertainment official pick the dossiers up off the floor, he then asked her if she would mule drugs on cruise ships for God and country if they gave her the opportunity to play her guitar and be a star on the cruise ship. She said, no way in hell, and threw her guitar right at him. If Cathy O'Brien had not come forward and told me her story, how could I ever have understood what Dawn told me of country Western stars being drug mules and how a well-known Hollywood star had raped my sister Dawn? Then I remembered in my early career a certain John Fisher that was a manager for the Eagles, Travis Tritt, George Strait, who heard me sing and said he'd like to make me into the next country music star. I turned him down because I didn't like his vibe. And looking back, I'm sure I dodged a bullet right there. So who gets chosen to be a CIA mind control slave? Most come from poor families, so if the abuse is discovered, they can't afford to pursue justice. They choose kids and teens that come from abusive families. Mental disabilities are a plus because if the victims remember anything and report it, they can claim the victim isn't reliable. The guilty parties of this world love nothing more than to call a person that tells the truth crazy. But there's a problem with that if you marry a man with a PhD in clinical psychology. The truth is coming out more, the dots are being connected, and those with stories are being heard. This is my husband, Dr. Dean G. Allen, PhD. And they lived, and if you want to know about this next picture here, there's my sweetie pie. We walked down the aisle with those sunglasses. I asked him when I realized it was him and couldn't be anybody else. I said, Dean, what's our life going to be like? And he said, it's going to be so bright, you're going to need sunglasses. What we're learning about Operation Mockingbird is that high-profile celebrities become CIA mind control victims as children or teens who are still used by the CIA. And when they start to recall being forced to abuse a child or kill somebody, they feel shame and guilt. Many commit suicide because they don't realize it was their programmer who committed those acts and not them. In many cases, they programmed us to think we committed crimes that never really happened. So in 1947, my father was a perfect candidate. Paperclip to Andrews Air Force Base was from 1945 to 1959. And I understand they took the Operation Paperclip through all the Air Force bases, and my dad was right there in 1945 when this all started. I understand they asked him 300 questions to find out if they had generational incest abuse so that they could be the perfect candidates, and my father certainly was. He spent the next several years in Virginia. His mother and father molested and neglected him. The church priesthood did also. He suffered extreme trauma as a child, and his father was from Colonia Juarez, Mexico, in a polygamy family. And there's also a connection with Colonia Juarez with Operation Paperclip, if you'd like to look that up. His mother molested him and hated his life, and he hated his life until he joined the Air Force, where he reported being fed regular meals and taken care of for the first time in his life. Because, you see, these are the throwaway kids, and that's the ones they like to use. My father was a chosen one because of his exceptional IQ, which was over 145. His bloodline, he claims he is the illegitimate son of a Utah senator, and that's before Hatch. his desire to follow orders, his talent. He was in the Air Force band, a very elite band, and most of all, his patriotism. He would cry over any patriotic song. When he enlisted, his children instantly belonged to the military too. Now, most people don't know about a term called issue. An issue is like when they issue you clothing. And you get issued children, and the military basically, in their demented minds, the parts that in the military that have done this, call you the issue. And you are literally the issue of the United States, whatever it is your father or mother joined up in. This kind of trickery on paper is not consent. Blind trust is not informed consent. This is slavery and why we have to put a stop to it. Now I'd like to introduce my beautiful mother. Now tell me, if you were looking for a breeder for DNA experiments in the military and secret government intelligence programs, wouldn't you pick her too? So with generations of unconscious baggage in hand, my mother was put into an orphanage and was not potty trained until she was six. She and Dad, who were both incest abuse victims going back several generations, got married after only knowing each other for 10 days in July of 1948. We lived in Glendale, Phoenix, Sunnyside, St. Joseph, Thatcher, and Wilcox, Arizona, and all through until our family grew to seven children. My dad started out working for the post office, which I now understand is the CIA. CIA get assignments, not choices. And his assignment after Arizona was to become a music teacher in Santa Maria, California, which is 15 minutes from Vandenberg Air Force Base. In 1967, our family competed with 300 entries to sing at the Hollywood Bowl with the famous King Sisters of the big band Hollywood era. And after that, we were made honorary members of the King family. And we sang, "Oh, when the saints go marching in." And that kind of got us started on our big singing career. I was the daughter of the music teacher between 16 and 18. We sang at church a lot. We played all kinds of instruments. And so I decided to start a singing group with my sisters. And there we are at the Santa Barbara County Fair. And after all those sisters, we had a little brother named Valiant. As the years rolled by, we kept adding to the Cumming Sisters and Company with more sisters and even our baby brother Valiant when we became the Cumming Sisters plus one. The Santa Maria Times plastered us on the front page news when we won our singing contract in Los Angeles. Dad was also working on an audition with the Lawrence Welk Show, which he got, but I was unable to attend because I was at Brigham Young University. This article was entitled, "The Cumming Sisters Hit the Big Time." My brother Paul Cummings was one of the few to beat the 4-minute mile. He was the NCAA mile champion right out of school. He went to the Olympics. He broke a lot of records. And his best friend in this world was Bruce Jenner. Ritualistic child abuse is the most hideous of all child abuse. The basic objective is to systematically terrorize children until they are forced to dissociate. The torture is the execution of a well-planned, well-thought-out ritual often performed by close relatives. The only escape for the children is to dissociate, where they will develop a new personality to enable them to endure the abuse. This new personality is very helpful to the abusers. Once the abuse is over, the core personality is not conscious of what happened. Dissociation also serves the purposes of the occult because the children have no day-to-day memories of the atrocities. They go through adolescence and early adulthood with no active memory of what is taking place, but continue in rituals through their teens and early 20s, unaware of their involvement. The victims lead relatively normal lives until they get triggered and flashbacks or nightmares occur. Now keep in mind that this is, and always has been, about money and power. It's about keeping the drug cartels, violent gangs, human trafficking, sex trade, child trafficking, child porn industry, and human slavery as alive and lucrative as possible. To give you an idea of the large sums of money involved, some children, even immigrants, are used in snuff films and dissected live for organ harvesting for Planned Parenthood and their body parts sold to hospitals for between $90,000 and $225,000, depending on the organ. Children with great DNA are also sold to families willing to buy them. Many of us have heard of the excretion called adrenochrome. The Satanists remove children's adrenal glands right after they've been terrorized and right before they are killed in rituals to extract this Kool-Aid the elites use to sustain their youth and extend their lives. Now, speaking of triggers, as I was going through pictures, I looked at the hands that were posed like butterflies. Butterflies are the symbols for the MK Ultra program, and the man that took this pic always wore a big Masonic ring. And that man was Ralph Adams, as you can see right here. He was also the town photographer. He performed on the Ed Sullivan Show, the Caesar's Palace, and Mike Douglas, and he made me levitate in his show and my sisters disappear. And don't ask me how he made me levitate or disappear, because I honestly can't tell you. This was the second magician we worked with. The first was Alex Houston, who raped Priscilla at a county fair. The memories seem to come in layers. For example, the first memory might be of incest. Then they remember robes and candles. Next, they realize that their father and or mother were present when they were being abused. Another layer is seeing other people hurt or killed. Then they remember having seen babies killed. Another is realizing that they participated in the sacrifices. One of the most painful memories may be that they were forced to give up or sacrifice their own baby. Each layer is something that has to be processed when they are healthy enough to deal with it. And sometimes the memory is as fresh as if it were happening in the moment, as the trauma relive explodes into the present moment. This is what happened to my sisters when their memories resurfaced, sometimes right in front of my eyes. They would get severe headaches, body pains, and they would often throw up. And then they would call me. I guess I was the family therapist starting at 10 years old. In the late 80s and early 90s, our memories began to resurface. And this is my little sister Pam, you haven't seen her yet, and all the way back to my mother and my grandmother in the back. When the story started, they kept coming, and it was all really, really hard to believe. By 40, however, I concluded that if one or two of my sisters were remembering these things, I could just write it off. But at that time, I'd already studied this for 25 years, and as a healer and researcher, I'd heard over 50 other stories that were all as crazy as what my sisters had told me. And with disturbing clarity, I was figuring out what was going on. When I was 52, I finally felt safe enough myself, with some expert help from my husband Dean, to finally recover the following memory when I was a little girl. I was heartbroken when I was forced to accept my sister's story as true. I remember being really young, like 5 or 6. We lived in Wilcox, Arizona. On this night, the women had me on a cart in the kitchen at church, the kind you would serve food on, so I was really tiny. The women were preparing me and telling me how special I was to be chosen and that I should feel really good about that. The women from the order seemed to be enjoying touching my private parts and lubricating me for what was about to happen to me. After they were finished with that, I was wheeled into a room to be raped by the men from church. I knew these faces. Why were they doing this to me? I screamed, and that's when I disassociated. Next, I remember hovering over my body, and for some reason, I was allowed to connect to those in the room and could feel and hear their thoughts of the men who were there. Several were like tigers with their prey as they were brutally raping and sodomizing me with great enjoyment. One of the men was feeling badly that he wasn't home for some reason. Another man was hoping that the bishop appreciated he was there because he didn't want to be overlooked next time the bishop chose new counselors. Then he took his turn. I was way too young to decipher the breadth of what I was picking up at the time, but over time have processed this, and what I got is that these men were past feeling on a lot of levels. Some needed approval from their brethren, but still the perversion was enjoyment. I cried for 3 days as an adult woman when I saw what they had done to me. It just so happened there was a healer in our house, one of Dean's clients, and they did an EFT on me and just loved on me for 2 days so that I could heal from that experience. One of my dad's CIA responsibilities was to create content for kiddie porn and distribute it. This explains this memory for my sister April. We are in the back of a big house that is old and falling down. There are expensive clothes and costumes in it. When we were in their control, they would put these clothes on us, wedding dresses, vintage costumes, and sexy negligees that fit my little sisters. A lady always showed us up to help us. We hated her because her help involved sex and pain. In Phoenix, Arizona, there was a White House next to a big park that I remember where we would roll down the grass in the summer. To this day, I'm allergic to grass. That's where we would have to go to see Dr. Greenhog. I hated those big hypodermic needles and the painful experiments. But then Dr. Greenhog would come in and give us candy. April said, I think we proved some of their mind control methods unsuccessful because they could not fully control all of us. We often escaped and would run out into the park. Dawn, Priscilla, and I often took our cues from Wanda, who lent us part of her ironclad will. So back in 1971, I was 16 years old and my sister Dawn was 10. She had just been gang raped. After that, my brother and dad had a terrible fight, the worst thing I had ever witnessed. I later found out what it was about. It was about who was going to have sex with her. My brother left home and joined the army right after that. My brother tried this again later on in her life when in her 30s, and she told me what he was up to. And we were going to have a family reunion. So before the family reunion, I went to his apartment with my sister. And I told him that if he was going to continue on with this, that he was going to do it over my dead body. And I got beaten up too. He now writes porn for top magazines. Dawn kept running away because she obviously didn't feel safe at home. To solve this problem, it was decided that Dawn needed to be taken to Los Angeles 4 hours away and put behind locked doors at a Catholic convent with bars on the windows. And I'm thinking, look, we're Mormon. Why is she in a Catholic convent? Mom? Dad? I remember thinking the worst that could happen to Dawn at a Catholic convent was becoming Catholic. The Mormon church had foster homes, so I asked my mom why Dawn was sent to that place, and her answer was, oh, well, the bishop told us to. April and I were allowed to visit her. We were shocked by the bars on the doors and windows, but even more disturbing were the special rituals she had to endure, one of which left her with a rose necklace around her neck. This was no longer our Dawn. She had a flat affect, and it was like, where's my sister and what have you done with her? It was all about shutting her down and shutting her up in a right to remain silent. So what's the purpose of Satanism? They want an army of mental robots that hide behind a light who, with the proper programming, will do prostitution, child pornography, smuggle drugs, engage in international arms smuggling, snuff films, and all very lucrative things. These psychopaths at the top believe they'll create a satanic order that will rule the world. At a high level of the U.S. government, there was support of this kind of thing with Operation Bluebird, Paperclip, Mockingbird, and of course, MKUltra. Still going on today. They justified it with winning the Cold War, but it was more about money and ruling the world. This is my first husband, Wade Lindstrom. As I look back, I can see clearly that it was an arranged marriage. As Wade and Wanda Lindstrom, we did a few hymn albums with the Juilliard-trained pianist Marvin Goldstein, set to a Celtic feel that went over really well with the Mormons. I placed highly in international songwriting competitions, had a radio show for 3 years called The Sounds of the Sabbath, and my CD album collection grew and was selling all over the world. And eventually I was named favorite female vocalist. It's kind of like the Grammy Awards for the Mormon Church. My husband was also part of my later career, and we began also doing albums together. Now, his family was all boys and mine was all girls. He had one token sister and I had four brothers and 10 sisters. And I guess the Illuminati goal was to connect one ritual family with another. His father ended up molesting the granddaughter and he is dead now. I was married to Wade for 25 years. I couldn't have children, so we became foster parents of 8 children. I also wanted to mention that his father was a member of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, and he told me that he was part of 2 branches of the secret government, and I thought, how convenient, as I look back, that he would be going around with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir all over the world. At the same time, he's a part of 2 branches of the secret government. So one of my kids had been chained to a bed from the time he'd been born and sexually molested by his mother and brother to age 6, and that really helped me to understand, as a foster mother, what happened to my father. I had heard similar things in my own family, so being a foster mother helped me grasp the patterns of what went on in my own family and contributed to my own healing. I later accepted a calling to serve in the Utah State Prison System in the Relief Society, where I learned that 98% of them were abused. I was assigned to the bridging committee, where I was often went to the bishop's storehouses for food for the women that were leaving prison. And I found out later from Cathy O'Brien that the bishop's storehouses churchwide are also used to distribute drugs, kiddie porn, etc. So going back, I'm 14 in this picture at a girls' church camp officiated by priesthood leaders. Now notice our military outfits. We were tortured in the next 2 years. We were used in secret experiments, raped in their evil rituals, and brainwashed. My sisters and I were not the only victims. My whole Mutual Improvement Association youth group that I grew up with was also used. We were sold to the federal government by our father and his priesthood and military leaders. And I can tell you names if you want them. Church camp with Pearl Knight. She's no longer with us, but she was also in my church camp, and she was also one of the women that did the experiments in the deep underground military bases at Vandenberg Air Force Base. I remember a red settee in a huge room in one of these bases, one of these underground bases. Just absolutely, there was no end to the ceiling. It was so high up, and the room was monstrously big. And there was this red settee in the middle, and my sister April and I were just about ready to get our hypodermic needle that we always hated. And I remember saying, "You run this way, April, and I'll run this way." And we would run and run and run, and we could run just like my brother. And so they always had a hard time catching us. We hated those hypodermic needles. But we would run, but we couldn't hide from those white lab coats. They did finally catch us and strap us onto gurneys, and they had their way with not only our pubescent bodies, but our minds as well. April remembers the day I got my eggs harvested. She heard my screaming as we were put through some terrible torture with the electrodes. Since she was the breeder, now I couldn't have children because I had endometriosis, which I now found out was something they gave me. They would use my DNA. Now this is going to sound really crazy, okay, if you are not familiar with this. They would use my DNA and implant it in her womb and then harvest the babies into advanced incubators when they were just viable. We often tried to escape when I would wake her up using their codes. I remember horrible earaches and a lot of time underwater. There were some experimentation, breathing underwater. And if you want to ever watch the Hollywood movie, The Deep, that might explain some of these experiments that they were doing to us. As a result, I hated to go swimming because if I got any water in my ear, I would often end up with horrible earaches. It's because I had a hole in my ear. April asked a lot of questions during the experiments when she was awake and was actually told the answers about who the babies would be given to and what would happen to them because they never thought she'd remember or tell anybody. She remembers that some of them would be called April. Now, I know that's weird, but that's what they told her, like naming the model or clone after the mother to keep track of them somehow. She said that some they did experiments on and others were sacrificed in the rituals. And she said for some reason a lot of the boys were sacrificed in rituals. Now, enter this girl. Her name is Kristy. She is from Santa Maria, California, the town I grew up with, but I didn't meet her until she moved to Utah and I moved to Utah. And she came up to me, and when she got to know me better, I actually used her as a signer. When I would sing, she would do the sign language, and it was beautiful what she did. And she finally told me her story, that her mother was a Satanist, and the reason she got put into foster care was that she was taken away from her satanic ritual family, which is no surprise coming from Santa Maria, California. Her story is that she is my daughter. Now the jury is still out on this, but we are going to have a gene test because her mother, admittedly from a satanic family, said that my DNA was used when she got pregnant in the labs. She said she was experimented on and actually told that the DNA came from me. The crazy thing is, and we only figured this out years later, is that Kristy's story coincides exactly with April's story, that she was used as a breeder to carry my DNA and the babies would be harvested early and put into the advanced incubators and finished to be used as Manchurian candidates in selected homes. April said that several of these children were named after her, April Cummings, and she has kept track of some of them over the years because she knew the families they had been given to. Dean and I found out one, we actually looked and we thought, this is so crazy. We're going to look on the internet. One of the people we looked at that were named April Cummings has gestures and looks exactly a lot alike me. Her videos are the strangest thing because she's a, what do you call those, a TV anchor. And she was in San Francisco when we first found her. We just looked her up the other day, and she's moved to the Cayman Islands. So you could look up April Cummings, who's a TV anchor in the Cayman Islands, and see what you think. So going back to when I was 15 years old, this was my leading man in high school in Babes in Toyland, and I had some grooming. I was the lead in every single play in my years in high school. His father worked at Vandenberg Air Force Base and eventually for NASA when they moved to Florida. According to my sister, he was also in the elite MK Ultra program. To train us, we were hunted at Point Sal in Guadalupe Beach in the middle of the night, and we were lucky to escape this alive. We had all been at the party at church. There was a hayride that we were all on. Steve S., who openly told me he worked for the CIA, was the driver. He took us up to the Los Alamos entrance of the tunnel. We were all stripped naked and taken to the beach where we were told that we had to make it to Guadalupe Beach without being shot or we would not live. We were going to be hunted. We had to swim or climb around the first set of rocks to get to the beach. It was a low tide, so it was fairly safe to swim. The moon was out so we could see, but then so could the people who were hunting us. We all stuck together at first, but the slower ones who couldn't swim very well were shot with a tranquilizer gun, but we thought they were real guns and we were terrified. We used the shadows. We helped each other as much as we could. There was one part of the rocks that we couldn't get around or over without a rope. And DR was tall, so he found a rope and set it up for the rest of us. When we got to Guadalupe Beach, we used the sand to cover up in. We then ran through the sand dunes as a shortcut down the road. We were running down the road naked and had escaped. There were six of us who never were shot at that night. Now, it started out as a lot larger group. And there's the names. Now, I don't remember this, but I can corroborate that we hung out and did a lot of plays together. We were kind of the smart kids and called ourselves the family. So as I look back and have now become aware of technology used in the MK Ultra programs, I feel that it's more than probable that a mind wipe had occurred when we woke up on the beach early in the morning, dazed and anxious. And all I could say is, Eric, you've got to get me home. Eric, get me home. I was really worried about what my mother was going to think. What I do remember is that Dad made us memorize the Jabberwocky that was written by Lewis Carroll, who is a famous pedophile. He also wrote Alice in Wonderland. Now, this comes in handy a little bit later. In my research, I found that children have been used in all wars. So for me, it's not hard to believe that adolescent super soldiers were used for the Vietnam War. What I have ascertained is that we were used as soldiers. We were taught to fly planes. We had more than sufficient medical training. April reports that on several occasions, we actually sewed each other up from wounds with remarkable skill during our missions to Vietnam, Romania, Colorado, and various underground dumb bases. We transported drugs and politicians to and from America to different countries, and if caught, they would always claim us as children and make excuses that went along with that. And this was really dangerous for the throwaway kids, but very, very clever. The craziest story is about Senator Jack Ryan. April reports that he died on one of our missions in Colorado right after he saved our lives. She also reported that Bill Clinton was responsible for his death. Now, I would love, Robert, to have all of this looked into by intelligence sources. Now, keep in mind that I don't remember this at all, but I will say that when presented with the opportunity to fly a plane two separate times, both my landings were perfect, and the people flying with me made comments like, "Wow, it looks like you've been doing that all your life," which is exactly what it felt like. April recounts, it was the end of the Vietnam War. The CIA had orders to take out some supply depots and oil derricks in North Vietnam and North Korea without being detected. They had just the operatives to do it. The six of us had been training for 9 months. We had flown the F-14 fighters that no one knew about yet. We were doing formations. We could land and take off anywhere. There were three planes that had two pilots each. It was Mach 3 all the way to Midway Island when we refueled. We were not told what we were doing. We were only out on an exercise, and we were in competition with each other to see who could follow orders the best and hit the targets on the game board. It was kind of like a road rally, only we were using F-14 fighter planes. This was no game. We had to read the maps and follow the directions that were encoded. We had our own language. It was cartoon character and Disney-based. And when April was telling me this for the first time, I really thought she was crazy. Then I read Cathy O'Brien's book and heard her testimony about how they delivered messages to each other that was cartoon and Disney-based. So over the years, as I became more aware of things like pedophilia used to trap politicians, deep underground military bases, the uses of children in these programs, secret societies, and the evil nature of those in power, I became more open to the possibilities that these things did happen. Families involved are rewarded for making their kids into stars and even winning local beauty contests. Which brings us to my next achievement, which I thought was my achievement. Right after our stint in the military as children, I was encouraged to try out for the junior miss for our little town of Santa Maria. I had good grades, and anyway, several of my church leaders told me I should do that. And in 1971, I was crowned the junior miss and flew to Santa Rosa, that just happens to be, as I look back, by Bohemian Grove. And we were supposed to sit at lunch with all these old guys. Of course, I got to sit next to Charles Schultz, who wrote the Charlie Brown cartoons, and he was kind of shy and kind of sweet. That year, I also won a scholarship in theater to Brigham Young University, so it was a big year for me. And the following year, they had a big deal at the Ethel Pope Auditorium for me, and that was the year my sister April was also competing for the Junior Miss program. At the state level, I won the Physical Fitness Award, where we danced Take Me Out to the Ball Game with baseball bats to choreographed routine. And my brother had just won the NCAA Mile Championship, so it was a big year for our family. And I have to wonder, what on earth did my father do for us to be involved in all of this? April told me that the programmers were hardest on me because I was so strong-willed, hard to break, and couldn't be hypnotized. She remembers seeing the electrodes they put on me and the pain they would cause me every time I defied them. She said that my reward for compliance was to become the next Junior Miss pageant winner. They were going to use me to spy for them on an international basis. She said we both proved to be unreliable candidates until they put an advanced implant just under the skin in our heads called a cap. At first, they were in our teeth. After that, they did use us for a mission to Romania, where we delivered messages to top brass there behind the Iron Curtain. This was during the Reign of Terror under the Romanian president, Ceausescu, with our college choir and sponsored by the Reader's Digest. Which brings us to Nabisco. My dad had many different jobs. He was a music teacher. He did lots of music lessons after school with parents that trusted him with their children. And during the summer, he had a job that sold biscuits here in England, or cookies. Nabisco, I've since learned, is a CIA front. My dad was a cookie salesman and would also stock shelves on the base, Vandenberg Air Force Base, where we got to help. This was our time to go with Daddy in the car and just one-on-one with a big family. It was a big deal to be able to be one-on-one with Dad. I remember getting there, but when we left, I always remember going through the date. The style would go up, but it would go down, and my dad would have to show his military pass, which I think is very interesting. But I was always super, super tired, apparently from the drugs they gave me. Each month when my period came, I was rushed to the hospital where my doctors would give me Darvon or Darvocet for my endometriosis, and I would sleep for days just to recover from the pain. And you guys, this pain was absolutely horrific. It was not normal pain. It was like, shoot her up. My doctor, Karamitsits, they would take me in. My mom, I would get a phone call. I would have to call her immediately. They would take me into the back, and they would give me a shot just so that I could survive the next couple of days. And as I look back, who knows what happened to me during the time I was asleep for those couple of days. April said, the ritual sacrifices happen more often than I ever want to know. I hope that is the worst memory I have to endure. We were copulated and sodomized after some of the rituals. They liked it when the girls were on their periods so they could taste the blood. This is the same group of people I encountered in the basement of the Salt Lake City Temple. As John Rappaport said, people need to understand the history of the madmen and murderers within these professions who were content to use torture in the name of science. The psychiatrist who later went to work for the CIA in the MK Ultra program were devoid of conscience. Any experiment was a good experiment. Human beings were useful subjects and is still going on today. This is the useful subject, my poor mother. I never knew my mother when she wasn't depressed, a condition that Dean calls a deep pressure that is unexpressed. When we lived in Thatcher, she was attacked by our stake president. She was used as a breeder and always pregnant. She had untreated diabetes, which looks like mental instability after a box of C's chocolates. And later they had her fixed up with, well, I got to know my mother when she was finally diagnosed with diabetes and was taken care of. The drag drug her under when she sometimes would go after us with brooms and call us evil. After a horrific life plagued by diabetes, my mother chose not to go back on dialysis after 8 years. She died 2 days after that. Immediately after, I started getting heart promptings to get my sisters together and start talking about what happened in the temple. I think Mom wanted us to compare notes. I was 17 years old and had just graduated from high school. There's the Salt Lake City Temple in the back. Dad was going to the solemn assembly in place of the bishop for some reason, which was very strange. At this Utah State Capitol building in 1972 for the Solemn Assembly. There's that picture. So in March of 2000, I got my sisters in the same living room and said, it's time to talk about what happened in the Salt Lake Temple. Now, April and Priscilla had been mad at each other, so what followed was kind of a miracle. April began to talk. Then Priscilla finished her sentence, and then Dawn contributed, and pretty soon they were all talking at once. Dawn was hiding under the furniture in the living room. They were crying and hysterical, and it was everything I could do to calm them down. What I pieced together from their testimonies that day is that in October of 1972, we were to sing in a regional children's choir for the Saturday morning session. My little sisters, Dawn and Priscilla, had gotten lost just before we were to sing, so my father sent April and I to run and go find them. We heard them screaming when we ran down some tunnels under the parking garage to the basement of the temple. When we got close to the screams, we heard a newborn baby crying. The baby suddenly stopped crying as soon as we got to the entrance room with a big red poinsettia on the floor where we found our little sisters. 8-year-old Priscilla was being placed on a black altar with a red tablecloth. We were frozen in fear at the door when we realized that a man in black and red robes, similar to the white ones worn in Mormon temple ceremonies, was cutting out the heart of the baby, of the little baby we heard crying. We knew that this man was a high-up leader in the church even then, but who eventually became the prophet of the church. This man recently died. He held a jeweled dagger as he held the lifeless body and tiny heart and took a bite out of it. April and I had seen enough. Dawn had found a hiding place under a piece of furniture, and while I was fetching Dawn, April grabbed Priscilla and said, "Those are my little sisters, and you can't have them." Bullets whizzed past our heads as we ran, but we somehow made it down to the end of the hallway without being killed by the men in dark suits. Spencer W. Kimball was not yet president of the church. He was the following year. He was a family friend from Arizona and the brother of Alice Nelson, who was my mom's visiting teacher when we lived in Arizona. He was not the man inside that temple, by the way. He was at the end of the hall. Miraculously, he was right there at the end of the hall and told the men to stop shooting and said, "Leave them alone. They've had enough." They hypnotized us when we were in the elevator, and since we didn't have enough time to get into our proper seats, we sang right where they put us as if nothing had happened. You may ask, why do these people do this to children? My husband's conclusion after thousands of clients is that these people are kind of dead inside, and the only thing that makes them feel anything sexually is perversion. The worst kind of perversion is hurting kids, so these folks have to hurt children in order to feel anything. And the saddest thing is that research indicates that the highest porn subscription rates are from Utah. Right after the incident, both April and I tried out for the prestigious Sounds of Freedom. That's April and I there in the middle. April and I were a featured duet and got to sing You and Me Against the World as a sister act. We toured areas where a lot of deep underground military bases were located, the Four Corners area, Albuquerque. We also visited Carlsbad Caverns. In a secret chamber in the caverns, April recalls another bloody ritual. I worried so much for the little kids that were still at home with Mom and Dad. I felt him go over the edge during this time. Looking back, after I left home and got married, Priscilla was raped by Dad. Christopher was beaten and sodomized. Pam and Andrea were preyed upon and groomed, and Roberta got pregnant at age 15. There's my brother, Christopher, after he had been severely beaten. Pamela began to date a guy when she was 17. Pam said Dad was actually jealous of him. Mom and Dad were staying with me after Dad got out of prison, so out of curiosity, I asked him about that. I could tell that he was instantly triggered by a strong emotion when he looked at me and said, "Why would she choose James when she could have me?" And I thought, whoa, my dad is not okay. Still, this is not a grown-up. This is a young boy with a crush. This is his arrested development stage. And then I knew why my Pied Piper father, why he got along so well with children. He was one of them. This is Roberta in overalls with Priscilla, Val, and Chris, and she's already pregnant there. I remember going to visit the family and going to lunch with Dad and my sister Roberta. After prison, my dad was no longer a teacher but was a fundraising director for area schools in the Henderson, Nevada area. When Dad showed up in his car, he said he'd been fundraising all day, the car was full of stuff in the back and not to use it. Roberta didn't hear him and she opened up the car to put her purse in and out fell a bunch of kiddie porn. And now I wondered what Dad was really doing in the school fundraising business. Was it selling cheap jewelry and candy or kiddie porn? And my final question was, who was he selling it to in the public school system? I get now that pedophiles are attracted to the teaching profession with few protection measures in place to identify and stop them. Looking back, I shudder to think of my father being in any public school system or doing those private music lessons after school. You may ask, why do these people do this to children? Dean's conclusion is that they need extreme perversion, and the worst perversion is hurting kids. Repentance has become a business for churches, so even victims are told to read more scripture, repent, and pay twice as much tithing as part of the repentance process. But my question is, what are the victims repenting for? The structure of our society, education, government, and military, is a structure of chaos, and churches are a big part of that. This is a structure of brutality, of insanity, of sadism, of fetishism, of cannibalism, of exploitation of the innocent, of torture, of murder, and of death. But love and compassion are the highest forms of intelligence and in human evolution. These elitists who program children have yet to evolve and don't feel emotions like those much higher on the evolutionary scale. But dark games don't fly in the light. Love triumphs as more and more are speaking out. I now believe that ritual abuse programming is widespread. Reputable sources are saying between 8 and 10%, depending on where you live. It is systematic, it is very organized, and it is in every dinky, stinky little town across this world, and it's high time to shine some light on it. I remember watching Roots and seeing the people that were called slaves. It was called slavery. But the worst kind of slavery is when those enslaved are so mind-wiped they cannot even recognize that they have been slaves, that they have been unwittingly experimented on, that their children have been tortured at home, at school, and at church. This is the face of willing slavery, because silence is our consent, and there is no reward for well-behaved slaves. Slavery is not upon us. It's been on us for quite some time. There are only two energies in this world. One is the drag on spirit life force energy, which encapsulates confusion, deception, manipulation, fear, and force. These are the powers of the dragon. And the other energy is love and light. The unevolved dragon on spirit life force energy thinks that if we don't stop what it's doing, that we are going along with it, which makes tribunals such as this so powerful. Because once we as a society can see what has been done to us, we cannot unsee it. And when those responsible for these atrocities are made accountable, then whatever agreement the dragon thinks it has with us is officially ended. One of my fellow singing friends is Sandy from the Lawrence Welk Show. Maybe some of you remember her. Her sister is a therapist, and Sandy told me once that her sister said, if the lights went out in every home in Salt Lake City where there was incest and abuse, it would be dark every night in Salt Lake City. because families wittingly and unwittingly become involved, and bishops and professors can become involved, and co-workers can become involved, and our own siblings can become involved just by following orders in the military. Husbands and wives, even our own beloved parents, can become involved without even knowing it, with their eyes wide shut, as the cycle of abuse continues with generational victims of church and state. To all victims everywhere, I want you to hear these words. This was not your fault. It's the fault of psychopaths that have long considered us slaves to be sexploited and experimented upon, and it must end now. My father is 86 now, and I don't know if he has crossed that line and killed a child or not. The point of killing children and spirit cooking is to get them to cross that line. Yes, they were all victims, but this is where, if they are aware of doing it, they always have a choice, because the powers that were have to get them in so deep that there's no way that they can get out. And until you understand dragon thinking, you won't understand. The dragon has its own philosophy, and that is whatever it takes to establish, maintain, and control. There's an old saying, the truth will set you free, but first it will piss you off. But we all have choices, and there is that line that gets crossed. Again, the lesson of the colon is to hate that which no longer nurtures us, to hate it enough to expel it and eliminate it, which will only happen when we become aware of it. We are not supposed to love this. The lesson of the colon shows us that we are literally designed to hate it, just like we hate stinky poop, and eliminate it. Consciousness is the only elegant solution, and it's high time to gather together and not let those killing children to get away with it any longer. How else are we ever going to have the peace on earth that we deserve? For the sake of any soul that they have left, we must mete out the appropriate justice that each one deserves, or it will just go on and on. My suggestion is to offer the worst offenders, who admittedly are not interested in changing, a pill that will end their lives, or offer life imprisonment. Because I am all for compassion, but that will not extend to child killers that can hurt children again and again. Now, for those shocked at this, it may surprise you how many offenders choose this pill voluntarily rather than live in a world where they are being found out. The dragon hates the light. The dragon plan is to shatter trust, to create a system that can do this automatically and generationally, and to control those with the most to offer. Psychopaths love the light as long as they can control it, use it, abuse it, and own it. That's what pedophilia and child abuse is. Meanwhile, untreated pedophilia leads to wolves in sheep's clothing, and the sheer numbers of victims is staggering. And these people are only discovered after harm has been done. To survive in a nation of sheep, ruled by wolves, owned by pigs, you must become a lion. And to all lions everywhere, I say, it's time to roar. Because every child that is abused by a government is one child too many. Every child that is abused by a trusted parent is one child too many. And every child that is abused by an authority figure in a church is one child too many. The good news is that this all ends when people start telling their stories. Only then can we see that they're all the same story. We are the jailers and the liberators, and by jailing key people right away, we can liberate ourselves. So may this tribunal eventually lead to not only compassion for victims, but justice for the guilty, because we are the ones we have been waiting for.
Rather than have three questions, this is a collective question, and it's directed not so much to you, Kristy, but to Chief Counsel here in relation to the role of the Central Intelligence Agency. We understand the abuse, the sex, the drugs and everything else, and we're wondering if Chief Counsel could comment on the advantage of the CIA being involved in these programs, and if and the dangers that of disclosure, like when people do come out of do come out of drug-induced and sex-induced disturbance. I was just saying to His Grace before that, and to my associate justice, that a friend of mine became addicted to cocaine, and he basically lost his mind. He used to go to parties manned by leading lights in the establishment, including judges, and they were served drinks and cocaine by naked girls, and that was normal. But he came out of it, and he recovered, and he wrote a book, and the book is a bestseller, and it's on the Amazon bestsellers list. So some of the people who were involved ended up in prison. He didn't, and some judicial reputations went down in tatters. So I was wondering if Chief Counsel could...
Sir John, I love being sandbagged and hit over the head with a 2x4. No problem.
But it is trained the obvious, for it. You're it a Marine
the,
officer.
It is the obvious question. Let me say that you'll have a chance to submit additional information for the record, including names if you wish, and we can coordinate something for follow-on videos.
Yes.
The obvious question is, okay, you've been a senior CIA officer, and do you believe this? Yes, I believe this. However, let me clarify that 90% of the people in CIA are good people trapped in a bad system, and there are at least 7 CIAs, okay? So CIA is not a monolithic organization. Also, when we, against the orders of President Truman, when Alan Dulles brought in all the Nazi scientists and so forth, they went to 2 places. They went to CIA, and they went to the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, which in our world we call it not a space agency. And as Cathy O'Brien has said so clearly, that's where the bulk of the mind control has been done. So just to mention the 7 CIAs as a partial and very brief answer to your question, there is the Wall Street CIA. CIA was actually founded by Wall Street to be its secret control element. And this is best told in a book by David Talbot, The Devil's Chessboard. Okay, and I have a summary review on it. Then there's the White House CIA, which does dirty tricks for whoever happens to be president. But the White House CIA seems to have merged into the blackmail CIA. CIA, at the worst level, appears to have joined now with the FBI, the NSA, and the Mossad. And so there's this aspect. And then there's the drone CIA, which has a 98% assassination rate. There's the Saudi-Israeli CIA, which does rendition and torture. And then there's the real sort of CIA, the old spies like me, who do their best not realizing that it's all a joke. And then finally, there's the bureaucratic CIA. I mean, I was threatened with assassination in a specific country, and 2 days later, the message comes in. I went underground in pseudonym in another hotel, abandoned my house, and a message comes in from a clerk at CIA saying, well, we're paying for your house. We can't pay for a hotel at the same time. And my chief of station sent back a one-line message saying, what part of assassination are you not understanding? Okay. So I've been there. And the bottom line for me is that the bulk of CIA is honest and worthless. And that 10% of CIA that does great evil needs to be rooted out. But I will absolutely assure you that the FBI, NASA, FEMA, DHS, all have their own 10%. And so what we're doing here really is moving truth toward clearing all of this out. And Chief Justice, you can get me tonight over a glass of red wine and I'll tell you the rest of it.
Justice Cleverly, was there another question?
Okay.
Commissioner Lena Hellstein.
A very little proposal. Very raw one. I'm sure we shall discuss later on. But we have a very brave and very still little practice in Lithuania, in the Eastern Europe. And I'm saying this because I remember your last sentence. Maybe tribunal, maybe somebody will help. This goes in the air because everything has, not everything, those 10 good percents in the whole bad body, first of all, must be helped by the new rising forces. And new rising force is coming from population. And that's why tribunal is born. So tribunal says, yes, we are beginning to say about ourselves. And We have a good code, the same in the UK, the same in the Eastern Europe. And that is the essence, non-governmental organization which has enough souls behind it can stand in the court. It's me who is doing that. I'm standing in the court together with such barristers as Chris. I go and stand in the court because if we tribunal people are only, yes, speaking, that's good. That's the first step, but it's not enough. We must go and stand in the court. We must go and stand in United Nations. As a non-governmental organization, having lawyers, we know very well our rights. And this is written in the code. Non-governmental organization has the right to stand in the court. That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Sasha.
Okay. Yes, Your Grace, you'd like a quick word? You have 90 seconds, Your Grace.
50
You're seconds. Excommunicated.
50 seconds. Thank you. Kristy, thank you. Just one question. I mean, how long did it take you until you woke up? And was it fear or shame that caused you to wait so long?
It was righteous indignation. Maybe that's what I would call it. I had gone to a Sunday school class, and I read something from the Bible, and I asked the question. I said, why did Moses cut off the heads of 23,000 people and put them on sticks and turn them upside down and let the blood run to the ground? I said, what God would ask someone to do that? And then to have the young children being given to the men and killing everybody else, leaving the women and the children. And I thought, what God is going to be doing this? And so I asked the question. And there was some ruffling of feathers, and I could see the priesthood, you know, upset with me. And, well, you know, God's ways are not our ways. And I'm thinking, I'm done. I walked away, and I never went back. I went home, and I remember the following Sunday, I decided to get out into the sun, to put on my bikini, out on my deck, and lay in the sun. And I started asking questions. Who am I? Who am I? Who am I? I'd heard somewhere that that's a good question to ask if you want to wake up. And something happened to me. I connected with something, and I've never really disconnected from it. And it just, I would ask a question, and the answer would be instantly there.
Kristy, thank you for that.
On the power behind the ITNJ. Add your voice. Sign the treaty.